The reason why I'm speaking to you from a kayak in my backyard is that it allows me to highlight several aspects that I want to get into today's lecture in relation to ecology and evolution. In particular, the role of global climate change and other forms of global environmental change on the ecology and the evolution of organisms through changes in things like floods, droughts, fires, temperatures, and therefore the spread of many organisms dependent on those sorts of environmental conditions. And the reason why it's relevant to talk to you about it from my backyard in my kayak is that 2 years ago in the spring, I was sitting right here in my kayak, but not on dry ground, because it was the floods of 2019 in Montreal, way past the 100-year flood. Now, those floods are increasing in frequency, and I want to talk about them more specifically at my cabin, where I also want to talk to you about droughts and climate change, in particular climate warming, and how it changes the distribution of forest pests. So around our cabin, there are three different species of trees that are dying off at incredible rates because they're being heavily impacted by pathogens and pests that are no longer having trouble associated with really cold winters. One of the trees that's been heavily impacted are willows in this area. And so here are a set of willow trees here that have all died within the last few years. So each of these has been heavily impacted by some sort of boring insect, presumably a boring beetle. There's a whole bunch of patches of willow here that have all died off because of this same insect. Another tree that is being heavily impacted by increasing abundance of pathogens and pests are aspen poplars. And so for the last 4 or 5 years, all of the leaves, instead of looking green, look gray or silver. You can see the tracks of the leaf miner as it is eating its way through the leaf while being protected by the external surface of the leaf. I think the ones that bother me the most are the spruce trees. And you can see it on this tree, these little dots in the bark and the bits of bark popping off. Hundreds of trees all around us, all of the big spruces are going to die of this. Here's a spruce tree that is at a much later stage of the infestation. So it's completely dead now, and you can see much more of the damage that's been wrought underneath the bark. So let's take a look here. And you can see all of the frass and trails made by the boring insects as they ate the living parts of the tree. And you can see the tracks made here. So these are often called bark beetles or wood boring beetles. So it's a parasitoid wasp, and it's searching for those beetle grubs, the ones that have been killing the spruce trees. Maybe he'll detect one. See his antennae vibrating? Maybe he'll detect one and you can see him drill into the wood. Oh, did you see that? Oh my God. That was so cool. Check it out. That's the actual ovipositor, and this is the sheath that it uses to protect it. So it pulls the sheet out over, pulls out the injector, drills into the wood, into where the larvae is. Climate-induced mortality of trees is going to have effect on many organisms. One of those organisms is almost certainly going to be the red squirrel. They spend the summer collecting food, mainly green cones from conifer trees, and stashing them for the winter. Then during the winter, they will dig up those stashes and they will consume them to keep them going during their reproductive period, which begins in the early winter. So this particular tree, which is about to die, like many around it, is a major food source for red squirrels. And if you look down here, and so this is the remnants of a red squirrel midden, where the red squirrel digs up the spruce and tears apart the cones to nourish itself.
in the main river, there isn't a big lake that buffers the effects of water flow. So if you get a couple of days of really heavy rain, then basically the water goes way up and gets really dirty. So out there, there's a whole bunch of really dirty water rushing by. But right here, two creeks come in that are big salmon spawning creeks. So the water coming out of these is both coming from lakes or low-lying areas. And so it doesn't rise as quickly or in particular get as muddy. So you have these two creeks coming in with clear but tannin-stained, high dissolved organic carbon water entering into the milky water. Back to flying the drone, which is up there filming the mixing of the water. Last year, I think I talked about how there was pretty big flooding when we were here in August. And it got much worse to the point that, you know, areas that were never flooded normally were flooded. When the water speed gets going high enough, it can mobilize the entire bed. And so all big rocks start moving, like rocks the size of my fist. And so that's what you see here, is that there's been a big remodeling of this gravel bar. If the salmon happened to have been spawning before that, then these sort of bed mobility events where everything gets stirred up will actually kill most of the eggs by washing them out of the gravel. It can have a big negative effect on salmon.
But I think also what's going to be even worse is increased frequency of droughts. And so in several past years, we've seen rather extreme droughts at our cabin where the water has been far lower for far longer than we've ever seen before, exposing huge areas of the stream bed to exposure to the air, preventing upstream migration of many salmon, and presumably having incredible impacts. These impacts can also be seen up out of the stream in the trees themselves. And for the first time ever, we saw spruce trees and many of the other conifers dropping their needles in incredibly high numbers. I'd never seen this before. The needles in the first windstorm blew into the stream and caused huge rafts and gyres of floating conifer needles.
Now, there's a lot of discussion of how signals that humans have created in this modern, modified world are influencing animals in negative ways. In particular, there might be certain sensory targets or signals that animals have evolved to use that are now maladaptive, given that humans are providing similar types of signals in situations that are not good. So, for example, my hat, this butterfly, is presumably wasting its time and energy trying to get nectar from my hat here.
So we think that we have just discovered another ecological trap. This morning I swept out the cabin and put the blue dust pan outside. And this is what it looks like now. All those little critters are not breeding in the right place.
The hope then is to weave together a bit of ecology, a bit of evolution in the context of global climate change, to continue to further set the stage for the lectures that come, which are more organism specific. This cursed butterfly won't leave me alone. I can't get away from the butterfly.
I think it went away.
Oh, wait. Did it leave? Is it gone?
Oh, no.
No, here it comes. No, 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 no. Ah! Cannot escape it. It's like.
Oh, it's coming to your hat.
It's like a horror movie where the villain just won't stop.